Thank you for the introduction. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the first of the post-lunch sessions for today. And I am delighted to be here to speak to you and have this platform to share some of my learnings and ideas. And incidentally, this is the perfect setup to be doing so right now, because today I'm going to be talking to you about failure. And in many ways, this has been set up in the perfect way by the speakers who have been here before me, speaking about fail fast, failing better, learning from failure, and biases that apply to the same. So today I'm going to be diving very deep into that concept, and we are going to explore some of the avenues that proceed from there. So my topic title is "To Fail Better is Divine," which goes from the adage that to err is human, but to forgive is divine. I posit the theory that failing better than failing fast is what we must strive for, because failing fast isn't enough. And there are certain steps that any discerning agile practitioner can take to avoid the pitfalls that come with it. Now, if you look at the image on the right here, can anyone guess what this is? A little louder. Some of the early attempts in human aviation, possibly not the best thought out one, for sure. In case there's any doubt there, that man did not succeed in his attempt. However, the point I want to make here with this image is that even the best of us are susceptible to failure. Would you believe me if I told you that this machine was designed by Leonardo da Vinci? The person that actually is responsible for many cornerstones of our civilization in terms of art produced, inventions, theories, that person designed this machine. Now, of course, he knew better than to take it to fruition and actually try to build it, so someone else did many centuries later. However, this was called the ornithopter, an initial design by Leonardo da Vinci. Even the best of people don't always have the best of ideas, is the point. So before we dive into the session itself, let me introduce myself. My name is Sherry Wasandi. I am a management consultant and organizational coach. I've been working with agile teams and agile practices for the last 8 to 9 years. And I represent Zebia, UAE, and at present I'm working on something called TAM. Now, TAM is a project undertaken by the Abu Dhabi Digital Authority, which is the largest digitization program for government service digitization undertaken till date. Now, what that program entails is every single service that the government of Abu Dhabi provides to its citizens, residents, tourists, everything can be accessed via one application. That means one app on your mobile phone for doing everything from starting a business, renting a house, selling a house, checking your children's report cards, getting them enrolled in a school, or applying for medical treatment, seeking consultation with a doctor, or sending in an application and request for the assessment of the fertility of your camel. Because it's Abu Dhabi after all. So that program along the way involves so much of coordination between different government entities with conflicting roles and conflicting interests that we've learned some things about failure along the way. And that has been what has brought me here today to you. Now, let's talk about our relationship with failure and how it's evolved over a course of time. Can I ask AV to dim the lights close to the screen? I first want to talk about how our relationship with failure as an industry has evolved in the recent years. So a primary catalyst for our change in approaching failure has been a rising market demand for rapid innovation. The way we operate these days, we cannot really sustain the pace of not tolerating failure. What that has led to is some reformed attitudes towards failure, and that was where it began. However, the impact that it has had stems and branches out in various ways. Number one is the acceptance of failure as a driver for innovation, largely in many organizations, companies, cultures, communities, which is excellent. The second has been an increased risk appetite, both from a cultural and a financial standpoint. Now, interestingly, the third has been this this evolution of the concept of fail fast. That, oh, you should fail fast, but you should fail often. Oh, let's tie in a few better practices and approaches to failure and call it fail forward. And then finally, we've arrived at a position where often you'll see in the industry failure as a badge of honor. You'll rarely see a startup founder at any forum who does not first begin with talking about their previous failures. In fact, there are conferences now, something called the FailCon, that happens across the globe. Basically, it's a set of people discussing their failures, and there are merits to this. But we must proceed with caution. And my point here is that the fail fast movement, in the form that it has taken now, has left the world somewhat shortchanged. So let's discuss. Developing a robust organizational strategy for tackling failure, any approach to failure, requires a balancing act. Because on one hand, giving people the permission to fail, it removes the constraints that limit their creativity, it energizes the teams, and it introduces a culture of uncompromised innovation, that there are no barriers, innovate, go wild, practice the ideas, put them to fruition, experiment and see what happens. But on the other hand, in today's competitive landscape, no organization, program, or person is operating with unlimited resources that allow us to put in a lot of time, effort, and investment into ideas that may not be great to begin with. Therefore, we have to put some checks and balances in place. And what fail fast is a good place to start. Now, in startup culture, starting 2001, this terminology has referred to the idea that businesses should undertake bold experiments on a regular basis, and they must check the viability of a product or strategy instead of investing a lot of time and effort in an approach that is likely to fail. That is it. That is where it ends. Therefore, any conversation about failing fast begins with fail fast, proceeds to fail often, and ends with learn better, learn faster, right? But the term itself originated in systems design in the 1970s, and the definition there was slightly different. And that really focuses on the fact that a fail-fast system that is effective must report failure conditions as quickly as possible. It is designed to stop operating correctly as soon as a failure condition is encountered, and a fail-fast module, its primary purpose is detecting errors as quickly as possible. Now, my question to you here is, of all of you, how many of you have experienced failure in either a professional, academic, or personal domain, by show of hands? Most of us have. And how many of you feel that those failures could either be mitigated or prevented? A lot of you as well. So there are several strategies I'm sure you have in mind for what makes it better. Hindsight is 20/20, they say. After the fact, it's very easy to say, oh, I could have done something differently. But there are some techniques to be observed and to be practiced to improve our chances of success. Now, failing effectively is a highly refined skill which is developed with very careful planning. And it requires vision, it takes foresight, it takes a lot of mature planning, and we must prepare our organization to leverage the benefits of failing fast before we actually do it. Otherwise, we're essentially driving a truck off a cliff. So it's very important to prepare your organization first for failure and then be in a position to fail fast. In order to get into the space of thinking about how failure occurs, let's look at a few case studies. Now, Starbucks, without a doubt, has been an extremely successful organization worldwide, and a lot of it is attributed to their business model. However, there is one instance where the organization has decidedly failed, and that has been Starbucks' expansion in Australia. Now, in the mid-2000s, Starbucks planned to open up in Australia, and within the course of 1 year, opened up about 87 stores in one go. And immediately, the response was not good. However, plying through the same business model, they tried to analyze why this is happening. First of all, Australia is really serious about its coffee, so it should be fairly popular. And the same model has been applied in many different geographies. Why does it not work in Australia? And the truth of the matter was that in general, there are many cultural specifics to keep in mind. You have to check if your product works in a certain geography. You cannot guarantee that the strategy that works in one place will work in another. In Australia, there's a culture around very customized coffee, not the very heavily branded Starbucks version of coffee, not as sweet. And there is a culture around learning to do it yourself, around the technique and art of roasting, etc. And Starbucks could not capture that market. Additionally, there was a very aggressive marketing strategy deployed, which caused so many stores to pop up right at the same time with a lot of aggressive branding, which almost caused fatigue in the customers, right? Now, on the other hand, at the same time, a different store in the same geography was performing extremely well, which is Gloria Jean's Coffee, which arguably and very clearly has not succeeded as well in other areas in the world. But why Australia? Because they, from the beginning, have a mindset of customizing the experience of having coffee and tailored it well to Australian needs. Now, another example that I think everyone has heard of, talked about, it's really done to death, is Kodak and the death of film, right? And we often say that they did not innovate in time, they did not realize that film is about to die and they have to move to digital cameras. But one part of the conversation that is often missed is that Kodak invented the digital camera in 1975. They were the inventors of digital photography. Additionally, it's not that they did not invest effort in digital cameras. It's that they did not respond fast enough to build enough expertise in the hardware of cameras that they could build it at a profit. Kodak sold a lot of digital cameras. They just couldn't do it quickly enough and with enough expertise in the industry of semiconductors to do it at a price that allowed them to profit from it. On the other hand, Canon and Nikon easily could, because they did not operate in film. Their expertise lay in semiconductors. At the same time, one very fascinating case study that I came across was Fujifilm. How many of you know what this pivot in Fujifilm was about at the same time that Kodak's failure was occurring? Great, could you tell me about it? Absolutely, the concept of Polaroids, absolutely, but that came later. At the time where Kodak was failing with digital photography, Fujifilm realized that their R&D capabilities were very well suited to some other use cases. So they did an analysis, and the director of R&D was asked to perform an analysis saying, of the entire inventory of the organization, what are the products that have applicability, what are the technologies that have applicability in the future, and what are the ones that are likely to die out? Now, interestingly, they found that their experience in handling film and gelatin films made them very capable at understanding human skin and how it oxidizes. So Fujifilm made a pivot into cosmetics and later stem cell research and artificial skin, which is so difficult to imagine, to think that you are an organization like Fujifilm that deals with digital photography films, switches over to artificial skin and stem cell research. And they're doing very well in that area. Having said that, the point of this is that two different organizations operating in the same space in the same time can have very, very different approaches to the same challenging market conditions, right? Now, summarizing that, there are a few factors. Definitely, there's a secret sauce that applies to how we can tackle failure better. And the way I see it, there are four key elements and aspects to it. Number one, if you do not know what success or failure means for you, for your product and your organization, how will you know which direction you're headed in? So you have to clearly identify, clearly define, what does it mean for my organization to be successful? What does it mean for my organization to fail? And how can I make sure that every single person in the company knows that? The second element is cultivating a culture of learning, because failure, when done without learning, is just a waste of resources and extremely irresponsible. The third is limiting scope and impact of experiments. Limiting how far a failure can go, how much damage it can cause to your organization, to your reputation. And lastly, iterate often, which is fairly obvious. Now, the one most important thing amongst these things is there's an order to them. Iterating often comes at the last, because unless you first identify your benchmarks and you create a culture for learning and you limit the impact of your experiments, then failing very fast will be of no use. All right, now let's go into each one of them separately. Benchmarking for success or failure. There are three steps to it. First of all, you have to begin with clear goals. What is the goal for your company, right? How many of you can very clearly list or mention or describe the goal of your organization? What is the goal of your organization? Expect more, pay less. And what industry do you operate in? Oh, excellent, excellent. See, but out of this, is there any other person? Any other hands in that I didn't see? Just one person, right? So one crucial factor to success, even the starting point towards failing better, is knowing what failure means and what success means. And so many organizations don't even actually step onto that ladder, right? Now, the next thing to do is to identify metrics that can take you towards the goal. Make sure that those are very visible to your entire organization, and ideally try and automate the measurement of those metrics. How many of us have either been a Scrum Master, some sort of change agent, manager in our organizations? On average, how much time have you spent in that role preparing reports? 10%, 20%, 30%, 40%, wow. For a person who is meant to effectuate change in an organization, preparing reports is possibly the worst use of their time. Because the less time spent in doing that, the more time you can actually make change happen, coach teams, coach the organization, resolve impediments, move things forward, right? So try to automate measurement of those metrics. And finally, broadcast the results and encourage a culture of not using metrics as something to be achieved. It's not a game between different teams to achieve the best metrics. It has to be the source for information, the source for you to study where your product is going and where to go next with it, right? So that is benchmarking for success or failure. Number two is cultivating a culture of learning. Now, this is where Agile and Scrum really comes in handy, because it's intrinsically a part of ensuring transparency in an organization to ensure you have retrospectives, you have various practices to do so. So things like encouraging transparency, revisiting tools in your HR policies to make sure that there is no block towards doing that. Don't punish failure. Don't punish failure. It hampers creativity. But incentivize early identification of failure. Make sure that people at all levels of leadership and management communicate this to all of their peers and subordinates, that it is okay to fail, but it is extremely important to try and identify that failure very quickly. Second, create forums and safe platforms that allow for sharing outcomes and learnings, knowledge exchanges, and encouraging communication between different departments and functions and levels of hierarchy if you have a hierarchical organization. And thirdly, providing opportunities for people to experiment freely, have conversations, and even take up creative objectives. Now, many organizations I've worked with have definitely tried it with, say, innovative Fridays, or having one day a week where you can work on some project of your own that you want to take to fruition, and allowing people to say 20% of our time will always be spent in some creative project that we then project and present to the rest of the organization. And the ones that do best are the ones that are taken up as a serious endeavor in the company, right? So cultivating a culture of learning is absolutely vital, and it must precede your attempt to fail fast or iterate very fast. Thirdly, limiting scope and impact of experiments. Now, the goals that we created in step one are big, long-term goals, usually. So what we need to do to make sure that we are on track is to break them down into smaller pieces and chunks. So create milestones out of those goals, and they have to be incremental in nature. Also, the progress towards those have to be made very visible, And you must review them frequently, because based on what the market is telling you, what the end user is telling you, you have to adjust those milestones, and perhaps if you make a pivot entirely, you have to draw up a new roadmap. But having incremental goals and incremental change is necessary. Now, another concept that often comes up, especially with the scaled agile framework or some agile frameworks, is dynamic budgeting. The fact that your budgets are too important to be decided on just once a year or once in 2 years. You must observe the performance of various programs, and based on how well you're doing, redistribute resources accordingly. And that, I think, is a very powerful concept that not enough organizations take on. Another, of course, is test automation, fairly obvious. Feature flagging, if there is something that you do get wrong, the ability to switch on or switch off a feature is quite powerful, and as is split testing and cohort analysis, basically launching a very risky feature or a new feature to only a small percentage of your customers and adjusting for time and place is something that will help you get better and richer information. And this ties into the whole concept of building, measuring, and learning quickly. And these are some of the concepts that come with many frameworks that you may have experimented with or worked with. And finally, once you've done 1, 2, 3, that is when you are ready to iterate often and to actually practice fail fast. Because unless you have those checks and balances in place from 1, 2, 3, you would be wasting resources in the attempt to fail fast. So, any questions so far? All right, let's proceed. Now, another thing that comes up with failure is being aware of your biases. All of us inherently have biases, which we also discussed and saw very briefly in the last talk. But there are a few that apply that I want us to discuss. The first being loss aversion. Inherently, we as human beings are loss averse. What that means is that if you have 100 pounds, losing 100 pounds causes you grief. Gaining 100 pounds causes you some pleasure. Now, our brains are wired in a way that loss and gain, even if it's of the same object, you will feel the loss a lot more than you will feel the gain. And for most people, this ranges between 1.5 to 2.5 times. Now, how this affects our decisions in organizations, in organizational culture, is that in general, people are wired to be risk averse. People are wired to err on the side of caution. Now, the origins of this actually lie in our biology. Our amygdalas are literally programmed to feel loss more, to feel pain more than to feel pleasure. Because think about it, in all of these thousands of years of our evolution, the people who survived were the ones who knew better than to run into a bush with a wild animal. The people who knew that there is a risk that has to be, that is over-assessed, perhaps a little exaggerated, were the ones that got to pass on their gene pool and so on. And we are essentially inheriting our genes from those people. We are wired to be a little risk averse. The second bias that comes in is called regression to the mean. Is anyone familiar with regression to the mean? If anyone's read, maybe Thinking Fast and Slow. Perfect. Could you maybe summarize it for the people here? Absolutely. That is quite literally the definition of regression to the mean. As an example, if you measure athletes' performance over a course of time, you'll find a certain pattern. Let's take an example. Any of you who've been in a position of managing another person, have you experienced this situation of when you give them negative feedback, their performance seems to improve? Whereas when you give them positive feedback, you observe that their performance has fallen or deteriorated. How many of you have experienced something similar? Right. Why do you think that was? Do you think that's a direct result of giving a person negative feedback, telling them to improve? Or do you think that people tend to get a little complacent when you give them positive feedback? That is the common mindset. But there's one thing that we often forget and don't keep in mind. On average, if you take 100 instances of any activity, 80% of the time you're likely to do average. The rest of the time you might perform very poorly or you might perform very well. Now, when you give a person negative feedback, even if you don't give that feedback, in the next instance, that person by default is more likely to do average, right? And if you give a person positive feedback, even if you don't give that feedback, it is more likely that person will be average in the next attempt, right? So it's a very humbling fact of the human condition that probability somehow incentivizes us for being mean to other people. It makes you feel that if you give give negative feedback to someone, their performance is improved, but that's really not true. So that's something to also keep in mind when thinking about failure. And finally, there's a very interesting bias, which is the survivor bias. And the SMBC comics explain it far better than I ever could. So let's look at this. There is this young man venturing out, finally entering adulthood, and he's speaking to his father. And he says, "Father, adventure calls me. I must leave my sheltered life behind." And his father says, "No, you must stick to the family business of farming beets. Be relentlessly provincial in medieval times." And he says, "But no, Dad, every hero starts off like this. Then the young man breaks free, braves danger, returns. He's wizened, he's powerful, he's learned so much." And then his father says, "That's called survivor bias. Adventurers who went a long time without being killed were the ones that you heard so much about, that traveled places, met lots of people. Stories were written about them. But the ones that ventured out and got killed immediately, you never heard about. So you only hear about brave men who ventured out into the wild and had great success. You don't hear about the ones who immediately got slaughtered." And so he says, "The only thing you'll accomplish by this adventure is you'll decrease the gene pool of people who are terrible at understanding basic statistics." And he says, "You cannot stay me from my destiny," and immediately proceeds to get slaughtered. So when we hear stories of failure from other organizations and other entrepreneurs, we must keep in mind that very often there is a survivor bias at play. You're only hearing stories of failing and then succeeding. You don't often hear stories of failure that ended right there. So keep that in mind. And finally, the closing note I have here is that failure is an inextricable part of success. So most of the projects that we're working on, most of the industries we work on today, most of the projects and undertakings we take on, they involve a creative exercise. Writing code is creative exercise. Designing software is exercise. No matter what other industry you're operating in, it's likely that it's a creative exercise. And with creative work, failure comes frequently. You have to try and fail. You have to practice trial and error to really succeed, right? So keeping that in mind, there are things you can do to cut your losses. There are some practices that as an organization you should instate, the four that I mentioned. And it's important to proceed from there. Let's not charge into the ideology of failing fast without preparing ourselves to maximize our return on failure first. And with that, I close my short talk. I look forward to hearing your opinions, your insights. Do we have some time for Q&A? Great. So any questions? Would anyone like to share their stories related to any concepts we may have discussed right now? All right, we can close early. I will be available here in the conference to speak to you about whatever ideas you might have, and I'm very keen to hear your stories. Thank you so much.